a lot of information.
What's up?
Yeah, so I was saying that your provisional, my understanding, again, I may be wrong, for to get a priority from the filing date of a provisional application, provisional should be complete in every sense that whatever you want to claim, there should be a supporting material available in all the documentation that you have submitted along with the provisional application. If that is not the case, your priority can be in question.
No, that's the part of Section 11, actually, in which we are talking about priority dates.
All right, sorry. Okay.
So what happens, I'll straight away come to Section 11 then, because that might be a question of many. So what happens is that each and every claim of a complete specification will have their own priority dates. Now, there may be claims in the provisional specification, which are not part of the, there may be claims in the complete specification, which are not part of the provisional specification. So those claims will have the priority of the date of filing of the complete specification. And now,
right,
in the now in the meantime, for example, within I filed a provisional specification on 1st January of 2021. Now, on 1st February of 2021, I filed another provisional specification with two new claims. In subsequent months, I filed multiple provisional specifications. Now, each of the new claim will carry the priority of the filing of that particular application. Basically, we are disclosing that particular claim on that day. So that claim would have carry the priority of that particular date. While on the complete the original the first priority would be the 1st January of 2021. So subsequent claims will have subsequent priorities. If I am clear about it, or if I am not wrong, basically.
No, absolutely. What you're saying is correct. I think there is a practical aspect to it also, why you would file a provisional application is typically when maybe you are in a rush and you don't have to get a proper complete specification with all the claims. You're not in a position to get it made, but you somehow want to protect the priority quickly. So
that's one of the things.
Second, to file a provisional so that at least priority is protected.
Second thing is that there might be cases when we have a fear that our employees or our associates would disclose the invention in public. So at that time also, we can file the provisional specification to at least protect ourselves.
Yeah, then again, it boils down to the same thing, because you are in such a rush that you don't.
You cannot wait for the invention to be completed.
Proper specification drafted.
Yeah.
Because, you know, somebody might disclose it tomorrow and within one day you cannot have a proper draft ready. So you immediately file a provisional with all the technical material which is available with you so that your priority gets protected, right?
So that's the provisional specification. Basic provisional and complete have been there. Now, coming to this, if anyone would like, because this is Section 9 is very important, so if anyone would like to have any comment or any questions regarding it, Form 2 is entirely based on Section 9 and Section 10. So these two sections are very important when we are coming to the drafting paper. So if anyone would like to have any questions or any suggestions pertaining to this, then that's very welcome.
No, you can.
Okay. So now coming to the contents of specification. Now, contents of specification, just if in your acts, please note down on Form 2 because most of the content, the specifications are actually described on the form 2 itself. So every specification, whether provisional or complete, shall describe. So every specification, whether provisional or complete, shall describe the invention and shall begin with a title sufficiently indicating the subject matter to which the invention relates. Now in form 1 also, we gave the title to the invention. That same title would be carried on to the form 2 also. The subject to any rules that may be made in this behalf under this act, drawings may and shall. So in certain cases, drawings are necessary. In certain cases, drawings may be necessary, but it's not a compulsion that you have to supply the drawings. If there are cases when our invention is not explainable without the company of the drawing. So in those cases, controller may require to look into the drawings. So for a safer side, we always supply the drawings because we refer.
Really funny that the standard says that the drawings are optional, but I have rarely seen a patent application without drawings.
Yeah, they are very rare applications which are without drawing. But the thing is that it's always beneficial to supply the drawings. Because ultimately you are explaining your application to the, while drafting the patents, it should be such that any person can re-engineer our product. Any person skilled in our act specifically states that person skilled in the art. US patent laws or the basically foreign patent laws, they use the term person ordinary skilled in the art. Our patent act is very specific about the person skilled in the art. So any person skilled in the art could re-engineer that product. So any patent should be like that. The drafting should be like that. So, and that could only be possible with the company of the drawings. So drawings are extremely important. Apart from it, every complete, the main part is this one, clause 4, that every complete specification shall and fully describe the invention and its operation or use. Then the best method of performing the invention should be explained. Every specification should end with the claims. Whatever you describe in the description of the invention, but you will be granted protection only to those that part of the specification which is described in the claims. So anything outside the scope of the claim would not be protected. Although for subsequent patent applications, they might come into prior disclosures, but they would not be protected. So in order to protect them, you need to include them in the claims. Fourth part is that it should be accompanied with an abstract providing the technical information of the invention. If you want, I can share you with share one form 2 on the screen. Should I?
Yeah, please. Yeah, please.
Yeah. Just hold a second. Could you see this screen?
Yeah.
So this is form 2. It's a complete specification. This was actually patent of edition. So it was not filed by me. It was I just downloaded it randomly. So the you can see the title of the invention is there. Applicant's details are there. Preamble to the description. Then a complete specification. The following specification particularly describes the invention and manner in which it is to be performed. This is a technical field, background. This is all covered in the description of description of the specification of the invention. You can look into this, that there are references to the prior art also. So in section 13, you will look into it. That whenever we there's anticipation, so we need to refer them. So these are the references to the prior art or the prior applications. Then there's this object of the invention, a summary of the invention, and a brief description of the drawing. So drawings have also been accompanied. Detailed description. They have actually, summary has to come afterwards. How come they placed it before? But it has to become it has to be included at the end. So that's something strange over here. And this is they are accompanied with the claims. So anything outside these claims would not be protected. All those which are included in this part from here. From here till here only, so it will only get protected. And this part is known as the preamble. This will actually be there when we draft the patent. So the first claim and the first line, it's the preamble to the claims. Now after this, they have again included the abstract also. Detailing the technical aspect of the invention. So this all is covered under section 10. Do we have any question over here?
No, not for me.
So in form 2 also, it's written, look, see section 10 and rule 13. So
then when we were especially in paper 2, when we are asked to draft a patent, most likely, you know, complete specification or a provisional specification, do we need to write in the similar manner, or how is it? I mean, from the exam,
it's always beneficial if you write in a similar manner.
Okay.
Now what happens is that look, we all are technically sound. We all are either engineers or somewhat related to the science side. So giving the background of the invention, giving the technical details is not a difficult part for us. But what we need to take care is that we should know the structure of how the form has been created.
Correct.
So you need to really work on it, you structure it correctly. Apart from it, drafting claims can be a bit of a technical thing, and that can only come with the practice.
Correct.
So, and I think that Quran and Qurana will be providing us classes.
That is the way you structure. Yeah, I think that's something which is pending. So,
yeah.
Yes.
So, that's the thing. And
okay.
Now coming to
Karthik, I have a question.
Yes,
while
ma'am.
Drafting, I have a question. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
While drafting claims, particularly we need to follow a certain pattern,
like what?
For example, qualification claim right now. So like a Jepson claim or something like that.
Your
is
voice,
there a particular claim format?
No, there is no particular claim format. It depends on what sort of invention are you, or what's the state of mind? Basically, if the claim forming does not contain a particular format, it just you just okay. need to take care of the of your language. There are certain adjectives or something. I'm
sorry,
not getting
your
that.
Voice is breaking as well.
One minute. Am I audible now?
Yes, you are.
Yeah. So.
No, I'm saying yes. Will they? So that is ruled out. So will they ask? Say, I want like 5 independent claims, or like restricted to 4. One independent claim and 4 dependent claims. Will they number? Because you know what I mean. Yeah. One. So will they give?
Hello. Yeah, I'm not getting a question basically.
Yeah. Will the are we required? Will the paper mention that we need to write so many claims totally? For example, one independent claim, and you can write 5 independent claims like that. So is my question clear?
No, your question is clear, but I don't think that they would specifically ask that to write so this many number of claims, or I don't think that they would do that. But even if they do,
because
even if they do, we'll have to practice claim drafting, and that would not be an issue.
Yeah, because I don't think they will ask to restrict the number of claims. That is my question, because it can be written in multiple ways. No? So will they ask, like you have to write within 1 to 5 or 1 to 7?
If I remember well, ma'am, from Qurana and Qurana classes, in one of the classes, they had mentioned that there is no restriction on how many claims are required. You will just have an exercise to write draft a patent application, and in that patent application you can write as many claims as you want. But the recommendation given by Qurana and Qurana was that you should restrict yourself to 3 or 4 claims. So they just want to test your knowledge, your ability.
Yes, one broad independent.
Yes.
I understood.
Three or four claims are enough.
Sorry, I didn't. Sorry,
I no, had no, it's all right. Like, yeah. Even we recapped our memory. So,
thank you so much.
No issues. So, contents of specification is clear. I would suggest that you could read it at the convenience of your, whenever you feel like, you can read the whole section. But apart from it, there has to be a body which needs to be taken care of. If you want, I could share that form 2 in the group. Hello.
Yes, please.
Yeah. So I'll share that, but the contents are, the form 2 is drafted basically based on section 10. So coming to section 11. So it's the priority dates of claim of a complete specification. We already had a word regarding section 11 when we were talking about section 9. So if anyone would like to have any question or something, we could answer that. Shall I continue?
Yeah.
So now coming to 11A, publication of the application. So publication takes place in form, we have to file form 9 also. And you can note it down in your act. It's regarding the subsequent rule for this is rule 24. And this is not same as otherwise. No application for patent shall ordinarily be open to the public for such period as may be prescribed. So generally what happens is that patents are kept secret till the time of publication. Now that for a period as may be prescribed. So the prescribed period is given under rule. Wherever it is written that as may be prescribed, then you'll have to refer to the rules. So rule 24 specifies a period of 18 months. So from the date of priority, from date of filing, not priority, from the date of filing of complete specification till 18 months, the patent is kept secret or patent is not published. I need to cross check, is it from the date of filing of the complete specification or from the date of filing of the from the priority date? Just hold a second, I'll just open the rules.
The rules is 18 months from the date of filing of application or the date of priority of the application, whichever is earlier. So there's also make priority as
well. So 18 months is from the priority date.
Correct. Either priority or filing the application. So be it provisional or complete, as soon as you file, or if you there is a priority. And that's why I think those cases become important, whether it's international filing or ordinary filing.
Yeah. Thanks, Mr. Sarang. So it's 18 month, and if we need to get it published prior to 18 months, we obviously can file Form 9. Otherwise, if you don't file Form 9, it would automatically get published after 18 months. So apart from it, there are three conditions when the patent will not get published. It is given under subclause 3, in which secrecy direction is imposed under section 35, which is related to, I think, national security and defense. I think section 35 is for defense. Yeah, section 35 is for defense. Secrecy directions relating to inventions related to defense purpose. So if there is any invention which is related to defense, then and a secrecy has been imposed under section 35, then it would not be published. Or it has been abandoned under section 9 subclause 1, or has been withdrawn 3 months prior to the period specified under subsection 1. So if before 3 months the application has been withdrawn, then that would not be published. Does anyone have any question over here? Hello. I would like to add on to it.
No, Karthik, you can go on, please.
Okay. I hope that I'm not boring you out.
No, not at all.
Okay.
Why are you thinking nothing like that? It's really important. I mean, we're learning so much from you from the practical knowledge point of view.
Okay. So, basically, till the time it's not been published, it would not be public, not be in public domain. So after this publication, only the post, the pre-grant depositions and all come. And one more thing, no amount of damages can be awarded for infringement of a patent prior to the publication. So in a lawsuit, if you go for, like, if someone infringes your product, because ultimately, as soon as a patent has been filed, the patentee would like to get it, even prior to having the patent granted, the patentee would like to exploit it for monetary gains. Now, if anyhow the patent gets infringed, you would not get damages for the period prior to the grant, prior to the publication, but it's only after the publication the damages can be awarded. And
I got one question here. I understand that the damages cannot be claimed before publication, but I mean, before publication, in the same spirit, I think even injunction cannot be requested.
No, injunction can only be requested after the grant of patent. Look, the catch here is that all the lawsuits in the patents case can subside only for pertaining to the infringement, can only be filed after the grant of the patent. But the damages can be claimed only from the date of publication of the patent. Are you getting my voice?
Okay. So there is no question of injunction before the grant, right?
No,
okay.
There is no question of injunction before the grant. The statute in itself is very clear.
Okay.
So 11B talks about request for examination. Now what happens is that our Indian patent system follows a deferred method of examination. So we need to file Form 18 also. And it's within the 48 months from the date of priority. Rule 24B talks about the time period. So until and unless the applicant or any other interested person, again, that interested person, 21T. So if the applicant himself or any other interested person until and unless makes a request for examination within the prescribed period. So prescribed period here is 48 months. The examination would not be done for the application. And if we do not request that request, do not file that request for examination, form 18 is there. If we do not file that form 18, then the application would not be examined, and post expiry of the 48 months, the application would get amended.
Okay. And Karthik, so can this request for examination be filed within 1 month also? Is there a minimum period also, or there is only a
there is no minimum period for a safer side. What we do is that we file Form 18 at the same time of filing the application.
Yeah, excellent. That's what I thought would make more sense.
So yeah. That would actually speeden up the process also. And we'll subsequently get FERs and the first examination report, and we'll have time to reply for that also.
So it's 48 months, right?
Yeah, 48 months is the maximum buffer which they have provided.
Okay.
Rule 24B. Okay. So examination of the application is under section 12. This was the request for examination. Now coming to the examination of application, whenever a request for examination is made for a patent, then the application and specification will be sent to the examiner by the controller, and that controller will generate the examination report based on the based on his studies or his research and all, he would generate an examination report. Prior art search, there are a lot of things going on in the patent office. So there are prior art searches also, searches for anticipation also. So they generate the examination report, which we call as first examination. The first report which will be generated is the first examination report. That examination report will be then sent to the controller, and then controller issues that examination to the that report to the patentee to give his opinions. If the examiner finds that the application is in order of the grant, then he would straight away tell the controller that okay, the application is in order of the grant, and he would forward the application. If it's not in the order of the grant, then the examination report is issued to the patentee, and then we need to reply to that examination report. So the first after issuing of the first examination report, it's within 6 months we need to reply. Now what happens is that for example, you get a report in January, in Feb you respond to that report. 1 minute. You get the report in January, and within by Feb you respond to that report. Examiner can subsequently issue multiple examination reports also, but all that process and then replying to that report and all that process has to be completed in 6 months from the issue of the first examination report. If that has not been done, your application would get abandoned. And if you reply to that first examination report and still there are clarifications which the examiner or the controller seeks, then they can grant you the opportunity of being heard. You have to go physically, or nowadays it's through online mode also. You can ask for the hearing and you can explain to the controller about how your application is in order of the grant. If they are satisfied, then they can proceed with the grant of the patent. This is the examination of the application. You can read that in detail. We need to look into the rules also, because I feel that the period in which the examiner has to respond back to the controller is from 3 months from the date of refer to the examination. So we need to look into that detail also. Within 3 months, you need to generate the examination report, and then we get time of 6 months for responding it back.
Sorry, I missed that point. I think your voice was lost in between. So what is this 3 months?
3 months when the controller refers to the examiner for examination. I'm not sure about this period. I read it somewhere that it's 3 months or 6 months. We need to get into it. From the date the controller refers the application to the examiner, and within that particular period, examiner has to respond back to the controller with that report, examination report.
Within 3 months, the examiner should generate the report after controller asking him.
Yeah, after controller refers the application to him.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So we need to cross-check that period, but it's around that month, that much only, 3 months something.
So the rules says it's ordinarily 1 month, but certainly not exceeding 3 months. So 3 months is the max time, whereas the normal time or expectation is that within 1 month can be done, but certainly not beyond 3 months by the examiner.
So I am not out of my memory from my last sentence.
No, sir, you are not.
So this was the examination of the application. Then search for anticipation by previous publications and by prior claims is section 13. So if we have already talked about that, if there has been any anticipation, so that all comes after the examiner generates the examination report. It can be anticipation from previous publications, from the prior arts and all. He could ask for clarifications, and this all has to be completed in 6 months. So all that is covered under section 13. Moreover, apart from it, examiner and the controller can ask for the amendment in the specification also. If there are certain things.
Sorry, I think the examiner issues the FER first examination report only after doing this kind of search, no?
Yeah, search for anticipation, prior arts and all. He does that thing and then responds the report back to the controller.
So he's typically expected to do this within 1 month as per what was told a little while ago.
Yeah.
And not more than 3 months. Right.
Not more than 3 months, yeah. So that is the search for anticipation. And in addition to this, we are having just 5 minutes for this 40 minutes to get over. So
maybe we can quickly cover as much as we can within these 5 minutes and cover the balance in our next meeting.
Yeah, sure. Because my throat is also
asking
me not to speak more. So
you have put in a lot of effort.
So actually, the thing is that I am also getting to revise all these things. So search for anticipation by a previous publication is in section 13. I would request that you all could read it at your own convenience, but I have just given you the background with section 12 only. So apart from it, section 14 is consideration of the report of examiner by controller. He considers that report and then forwards it. So this is again in continuation of that only. Okay, so we are in the we'll quickly read that, that wherein in respect of an application for a patent, the report of the examiner received by the controller is adverse to the applicant or requires any amendment of the application, the specification or other documents to ensure compliance with the provisions of this act or of the rule made thereunder, the controller, before proceeding to dispose of the application in accordance with the provisions herein after appearing, shall communicate as expeditiously as possible to possible the gist of the objection of the applicant, and shall, if so required by the applicant within prescribed period, give him the opportunity of being heard. So prescribed period is 6 months, and gist of the application is the examination report, the FER, first examination report, or subsequent examination report, which is generated. So this this section talks about that. Section 15 to 20 are the powers of controller. So section 15 is refuse or require amended application in certain cases, that is after generation of the examination report. Section 16 is power of controller to make orders respecting division of application. So if at any point of time, controller feels that the application should be divided into subsequent division application, he can ask to do so, or a person, this section 16, I think we discussed in our last class also. So section 16, if any person interested, not person interested, if a person who has made the application, so that means that applicant wishes for division of his application, he can request that also. So section 16 talks about that. Section 17 is power of controller to post it. So I'll quickly go through it. It's a very important concept of post dating. If you all remember this, post dating basically means shifting of the priority to the future date, and that could only be done up till 6 months. That's not in the rules, that's in the act, which says that post dating cannot be done later than 6 months. And the benefit of post dating is that you get a you can have extended period of filing complete specification. Downside is that you lose on your earlier priority. So it is only done when you are very sure that there cannot be any anticipation or any disclosure in between, and you are safe to post it. It should not be done arbitrarily. So if anyone has any question regarding post dating, he can ask me those questions.
6 months ka bataiye kya keh rahe hai, thoda 6 months ka kya
hai? Sir, ye dekhiye, main highlight kar deta hu. 6 months se zyada post date nahi kar sakte. So the maximum period to post date the application is only 6 months.
Aur ye main 12 mahine ke andar andar kabhi bhi request kar sakta hu.
Yep, aap not even 12, ha nahi, theek hai, within 12 months.
Mane 12 months ka bhi hai, ye mere ko 12 mahine ke andar andar hi request karna padta hai. And let's say
nahi sir, aap I'll just go through it. Just read the line, subject to the provision of section 9 at any time after filing of an application and before the grant of the patent.
Okay. So isme 12 months ka nahi hai. Okay.
No, isme 12 months ka nahi hai. Isme, but isme benefit yehi hota hai that if you file a provisional specification and you are not through with the complete specification within 12 months, you can ask for the post dating and you'll get a buffer period of 6 months again. But you'll lose on your priority.
Okay.
So that's the benefit of this. And 18, 19 and 20 are left. We are almost through with the time. Less than 1 minute is left.
Thank you so much, Karthik. You're really helping a lot.